She wants to send them back, and not just to any place. She wants to send them back to a new country called Blanga.
Not Blanga by any chance.
Blanga. So I'm like really amazed that, please help me, what is Blanga?
Sometimes I wish these sort of people, there's a list of people that can be stopped, you know, from writing in.
Yeah, but
you know what I mean?
But take away their privileges for a while.
There
right?
needs to be some monitoring by the sites as well, you know, because it cannot be a free for all where the lowest common denominator is the one that gets the most attention, because you know that's how the algorithm works. People look at this, they get outraged and they respond, and then that pushes that comment to the very top.
But I'm thinking people who have been living in the country, in your country, and suddenly the skyline which we see is built by these people, and at this stage you don't even know one where they're coming from, this foreign planet called Blanga. And then you don't even know what to call them. And the idea is send them back, because then Blanga is all waiting to just take them back. And second of all, it's not because of the virus. It's because it makes us look bad.
Yeah, I know. It's terrible. You know, it really is. Again, you know, there are always going to be people like that. I think it's idiotic. You know, one funny thing about this is about the Bangla is that, you know, an American friend of mine was asking me, you know, because he was looking at this and he said, you know, what is Blanja? Blanja, he was trying to pronounce Blanja. It. And I didn't know what he was talking about. I said, Blanja means to treat someone to dinner. And he said, oh, okay, that's very nice. They're asking to treat these people to dinner then, you know. And, you know, it was later when I looked at it, I was like, oh, Bangla, that's not Blanja.
So what are the other names that they are called? Just to go through this. So there's Bangla, then what else? Blanja?
Bangala.
Blanja is good. Yeah. We should Blanja then.
You know,
Bangra, even a dance turns into, you know, Bangra, some people refer them as Bangra, you know what I mean?
You know, they are from Bangladesh.
It reveals not only how little they know, but how little they care to know.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Ignorant.
That is the worst kind of racism. You know? When you decide to put people together under one label and just dismiss them. And whenever they look bad, send them home. You know, they're all optional.
But sadly labeling is a Singapore thing as well, isn't it?
Well, there's innocuous labeling, and then there is malicious labeling, you know, and you have to draw the line, obviously.
No, but I think in this case...
But people don't know where that line is. They don't even know that they're supposed to be drawing that line.
Well, you know, then I think it's up to the rest of us to educate them, because it is very important for society to show these people they cannot get away with making these kinds of statements. Maybe you can say you have the freedom of speech to say this, but I have the freedom of speech to rebut you and show you how incredibly ignorant and xenophobic you are as well. I think that's very important.
With what I'm about to say doesn't necessarily mean that I disagree with what Gilbert has said, But when you say we're going to need to have someone to educate them, then who would that someone be?
It's the community. It's the rest of the community. It's all of us who are reading it.
But it is now so prevalent. It does seem to me, it does seem prevalent, doesn't it? That so many people are talking rubbish, you know.
So again, the thing about online, you have to be very aware of. Yeah. The voices of a small group can become very amplified online and become representative and not at all representative, basically. That's very important to recognize.
I agree. No,
you can't save the older racists. You know, okay? You know, you can't teach these old dogs new tricks, all right? You can score them online. Yeah. Chances are they'll get even more defensive. Because as far as they're concerned, you are wrong. So,
I don't think the point is
the young people are not doing it. Are you saying the young people are not doing it?
No, so that's the
you're saying that we can't change the older generation, but
yeah.
We need to use the kids to shame their parents. Because the
Are the kids doing it? Have you been reading anything?
I haven't seen. It tends to be older people, like, you know, our age and up.
Yeah, which is a good thing.
I really hope so.
Hold on, guys. On what are we basing this assumption about the age? Because, you know,
you can look at their profiles on Facebook.
Because yeah, it's generational. It's generational also.
Yeah, it is generational.
Bangla is a term that came from, you know, a few decades ago when really most of them probably did come from one place. And then their understanding never progressed. As Singapore progressed, their thinking is still their grandfather's thinking.
So when So when a young person wants to address them, I use the word, I hear the word a lot, like foreign workers.
Yes. Because their generation has the vocabulary. Correct.
I don't think foreign workers is also a respectable term. Yeah. I mean, they don't know these are Bangladeshi from the country of Bangladesh.
I just think we're assuming too much. I think I can agree that the older generation, yeah, they're used to doing so, this sort of stuff, and they need to be, you know, people need to educate them, sure. But it doesn't mean that the younger lot not either, you know.
But you know,
I have heard younger people do this.
I have gone to every profile where I've seen these inflammatory sort of comments, and I actually look at the person's profile. Now there are some which are anonymous where they put up, you know, some fake photograph of like a building or car or something like that, but you kind of ignore those there. I think it's also very good to stress one point here that many people are overseas. When you talk about migrant workers, if you don't use the term foreign workers, you use the migrant workers, right? Many of those who are here in Singapore are also from China. They're not just from South Asia.
From Bangladesh.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, many of them are also infected. So that's important for all of us to realize as well, you see.
Yeah.
And these trolls who are saying to send them back to Bangla or whatever it is, you know, they need to realize this as well. But I think the problem is that...
To the foreign planet of Blanga.
Yeah. I think what worries me, really, is that, I mean, Gilbert's right, right? You know, the stuff that we see on the feeds tends to come from a certain demographic, simply because the younger people aren't the ones commenting. They can't be bothered. They're probably not even reading these posts, because most of these issues are not on their feeds. They're all talking about Korean dramas, and they're
Do you think the younger ones are watching our show?
But at the same time,
they're much more on YouTube than they are on Facebook. Parents.
They're learning these words from their parents. And if the schools do not reinforce that these words are not acceptable, even if your parents use them, you shouldn't, because you have progressed, then sooner or later they will fall into that habit.
Correct. John,
when they are older, they will comment.
I absolutely agree with you, because I know, I just need to tell you, I have heard the word mama. I remember when I came to Singapore also many years back. Now, it's okay, because in those olden days, they used to say things like, oh, you know, you're a mama or you're a mommy. And then I sort of understood that I'm Indian, so I'm mama or mommy. But then that was my question. But actually, and realized that just the young people also move on, and they also shake their head every time you talk, and they say, hello, hello, auntie, what are you doing today? As though that is the way we all continue talking. I have a feeling that this might be coming down. That, okay, that's the way they talk, and we are shaking our heads and we are doing the Bollywood dancing.
Because
we've been rattling on from just now. We've been rattling on from just now, but do we realize or not whether we're being recorded? Are we being recorded? Is the show started? The show has started, right?
3, 2, 1. Welcome to Happy TV's podcast.
Raw, brazen, and comical. This is the ultimate podcast. I-O-H-O, in our humble opinion.
Hey, shut up, la.
Welcome, welcome, namaste, namaste, and welcome to our podcast, In Our Humble Opinion.
I-O-H-O.
You better get used to that, because we are going to call, every time we say In Our Humble Opinion, we are going to go, ayo, that's the nickname that we've given for our podcast. Yeah, that is. Now, we heard RPM, and the moment he said the CB is going to be extended, though it wasn't much of a surprise, we could actually hear whole of Singapore, this collective sound. Oh no, another 4 weeks. I'm sure you guys heard it as well, okay? And though it was not a surprise.
Actually, it's 6 weeks, because you add on the 2 weeks that we have.
Absolutely. But so what I want to just start off with and say is that, yes, there has been a lot of, you know, strife, and it's tense and it's turbulent. But I would like to start the show by saying, let's look at the bright side of life. And I'll give you an example, okay? So, first of all snacking has come to an end. No more cheesecake, no more durian cake, no more pandan cake, no more bubble tea.
No bubble tea, bubble tea.
Things bubbling. And so, what the CB has done is what the government could not do. Kick diabetes in the ass.
Okay, I disagree. You know why? A couple of things.
And one more thing. We are saving a bit of money. So that's good news as well.
Okay, all right.
But like I said, everything you're going to say, Gilbert, I'm going to turn around and look at the bright side of life.
Sure. And
to start...
Let's just be realistic. First of all, the bubble tea places are only closed until May the 5th. After May the 5th, they will reopen, okay? Assuming there's no huge breakout.
Yeah.
Secondly, I know many people who are sharing how to make your own bubble tea at home recipes.
That's okay. So, you're learning. It's DIY. You're doing things at home. You're learning.
And there's nothing to stop people from buying a lot of sugary stuff in the supermarkets. So I'm with you. I think that we need to watch our diet more because... Shockingly, and I'll share this with you, is that Singapore has the second highest diabetes rates in the developed world. So, you know,
I know
that is something.
And that's why I'm trying to look at the bright side of life. Stop already.
And you're not helping, Gilbert.
I cannot. 2 weeks of no snacking. 2 weeks. Save a little money. Diabetes goes down. You get a bit healthy. And... I can see one other thing. Social media is so active, so vibrant, so kicking and entertaining. And so I'm going to start by bringing up something really entertaining and I want your humble opinion.
Okay.
Does coronavirus spread through farts? No. And I'm not just telling you this. This is a theory that is being talked about. It is scientific, okay? I mean, it's more scientific than stop eating beans. Again, because, beans. You know, the farting variety. So, does coronavirus spread through farts? Over to you guys for your humble opinion.
I mean, I seriously hope it doesn't, because then they'll be forcing us to wear masks at both ends. And that'll be really
uncomfortable. Well, you have something big, underwear and pants. So.
You mean diapers, disposable diapers.
Exactly, okay. Right?
No, what's the scientific thing? Gilbert, Chris, you want to share?
Who knows?
I don't know.
Okay, well, I mean, scientifically, they have found that there is virus in feces. So that N does have viral load for people who are sick.
Okay.
The chances of you getting it is entirely different because, you know, I would say that you have a better chance of winning the lottery than you would of catching coronavirus from someone's fart when you're out in public because, you know, I mean, come on, you know.
Well, unless you have always tied your shoelace, you're low down there and everyone around you is farting in your face.
And that person is not wearing underwear or a pair of jeans. I mean, come on, you know.
And you know it's by water droplets, so you have to look out for wet farts versus dry.
Oh, yeah. You guys said it all. I don't have to say a word now.
It has degenerated to this point. Can we move on?
Why move on? I think it's so damn interesting, man.
Chris, you take it from here then.
I mean, but you guys said everything I wanted to say. I mean, if you're wearing boxers, then your chances are, you know, how many ply boxers are those? If you put on 3 pairs of boxers at a time, you got 3 ply boxers. So even if you fart,
I think that to officially say something, you know.
Yeah.
Okay. I was not trying to go there. I was trying to say that it is scientifically being looked at. Just like at one point of time, they told us that cows farting is bad.
That is true. That is true.
So that's the way I put it up. Now, I didn't talk about all these plies and fibers and...
Daisy, do not absolve yourself from this. You started this, okay? You're not absolved from this.
So to sum up Gilbert's information, right? It is possible that there is the virus in farts, but unless you are squatting down behind people's butts and they're not wearing pads, you're probably safe.
Okay.
From that particular form of transmission.
Right. So that's the bright side of life. That's the bright side.
in that mood of, sort of,
what a way to start, Daisy.
Okay, in that mood of lightness, right? I have something I want to ask you guys, right? So someone was recently accused of making light of a serious situation, right? Recently, there was a comic that was launched by GovSG, you know, from a local artist who was trying to sort of put an interesting heroic spin.
The virus vanguard.
The virus vanguard, yes.
And he got slammed by lots of people, right? And one of the main arguments they had was, why are you making light of what's happening? GovSG released a statement, right? You know, one of their usual sort of non-apology statements, right? And what they said was, oh, by the way, you know, we've taken it down to review it. But by the way, it was actually drawn by this guy and this group of people. And I'm really suspicious of that fact because, you know, you don't credit the person when you first launched the work. There was nothing, not even like, you know, his signature at the side, nothing at all. And then the next day when people aren't happy, you go, oh, by the way, it's him. He did it. Right? So, you know, we're familiar with the strategy and I really find it distasteful and ungracious, you know. But what's happening then is people started writing back, you know, people started sort of joking about things. Some friends of mine actually created sort of counter parodies of that using food and stuff like that, you know. So that proves the point, right? That everyone is using their own sense of humor to try to make sense of what's going on, to try to survive a bad time. So please don't blame this poor artist for doing that. You know,
I also think, John, and I agree with you there, because I really believe that humor is such an important part of your life at all times, because that's what actually dissipates a very, very strenuous situation like we are in now. Having said that, I think when I read what the writer, I mean, when the cartoonist had to say, it was also about the similarity of some of the cartoons. And that is a copyright issue.
Yeah, a couple of days later, it was pointed out.
Because I'd like
you know, it's
look.
I feel sorry for these guys. You know, I feel sorry for these artists. I mean, look, here you are trying to promote your craft, right? And trying to get, you know, a cartoon drawing and what do you call this? This interest, this form of interest.
Yeah.
You know, off the ground, getting people comic more art, interested in it. You know, and local artists, comic artists, cartoonists. Thank you. You know, getting the names off the ground, and it's difficult for these guys, right? And then now, because of this COVID-19, government asks them, whichever ministry or stat board approaches them to get this job done. They must have given them a brief. You know, and I mean, come on, people in creators and media, you know, right? They would have given them a brief, and who knows about whether there's been grief in the brief they've given.
The brief,
yeah. And at the same time, for people who have done work with them, you know, sometimes the ideas can be quite, lack of a politer term, lame. And then it comes across, and this is the brief that's been given. And before they launch it to the public, right, it has got to be approved by the client. So why are these guys being made to look like idiots?
But to tell you frankly, I saw it. I mean, it was very, it looked like fun. If it had been given a chance, you know, like you said, your friend's working on it, you know, and it could have added in humor and creativity and suddenly all those superheroes going around. I was quite excited by it and I wanted to look further and then it was gone.
Can I add my 2 cents worth here? I think there's several issues here that we need to look at, right? When this first came out, I thought it was fantastic. I thought it was fine, no problem there whatsoever. The issue came about when people started complaining about the Manchester United slogan about you'll never walk alone. And then that took off a life of its own and people started getting angry because they were football fans that didn't like that. So that I thought was incredibly stupid and frivolous. Yeah. Like, you know, in a world where people are dying by the hundreds of, by the thousands and hundreds of thousands are getting infected, this kind of a problem you want to make noise about is so frivolous, okay? Yeah. So that was one thing. Then there was accusations of plagiarism, which I thought was a very serious thing, saying that he had traced some stuff. Now, that's a totally separate issue, because if that happened, then that needs to be looked upon by itself.
And he has acknowledged it. He has acknowledged it. He has apologized. He has written apology.
He was forced to, or he made the decision to resign from that band of doodlers that he was a part of. Okay. So there are different issues here. Yeah. There are different issues here which I think conflated together. You know, one was the whole soccer thing. You know, one was people with no sense of humor, taking umbrage at this, you know, then the plagiarism thing. So,
no, but the plagiarism.
Wait, Gilbert, I'm a Manchester United fan.
Okay. So would you have liked to pull it down?
No, did it upset you?
No, Chris, it didn't upset me.
I laughed about it. As a matter of fact, even some of my Liverpool friends, I mean, we may be rivals where the football is concerned, but we are friends still, right? I'm not going to break up friendship because of the football clubs we support, right?
Yeah, like who are these hooligans?
But we laugh about it. I mean, at the end of the day, going into the football, the realm of this football rivalry, this big, you know, it's globally known, famous, do not mess with this rivalry kind of thing, right? I mean, who gave them that idea, you know? I know it may sound frivolous, but maybe we should also, people, anyone for that matter, whatever work you do, you got to at least be sensitive enough to not go into areas that's going to blow up your efforts. Yeah.
If the young artist and learning about the sensitivities out there in the public domain,
I think this is the brief.
So this is what I wanted to say, Chris, earlier, talking about the brief and the oversight, right? My biggest question, and I think to me the deepest issue that this whole thing raises, is how did this go from one young artist's imagination to a public campaign launch with all those mistakes in place and all that, you know, cluelessness and innocent naivete in place? Were there not several civil servants along the way, several PR people, several whatever, you know, to help this boy clean up the idea?
But John, can I just interrupt? Sorry, yeah? This question you should be able to answer yourself, because this is exactly what happened when they had that advertisement. You remember?
So it went through the whole gamut.
I think that's
what advertisement? What advertisement?
This was the Nets advertisement that went out last year. The famous brown face Nets
advertisement.
This was a multi-agency collaboration.
There were at least dozens of people involved. And this same question was asked. Dozens of people. Ultimately, the actor got the flak. And everybody else was gone, and Preeti who sang about it.
Some information has come to light about this band of doodlers situation, which makes it slightly different from the Net situation. On first glance, it looks like basically absence of oversight, right? But it's two different types of absence of oversight. With the brown face thing, it was really institutional ignorance. Because I know for a fact that they actually did conduct polls before it was launched. And somehow those polls happen to reflect that everyone will be fine with this brown face thing. So clearly there's an issue there. You know, sensitive enough to try to figure out, and then sensitive enough to take the wrong message from what they research. In this particular case, I strongly believe that there was no brief. Because the original superhero fighting the virus idea was from Band of Doodlers. None of them were commissioned. It was a group of artists all instinctively responding to make heroes of our frontline fighters, right? That's great. That's what they always do.
That's good,
but none of them officialized it. They just shared it on the internet and stuff like that, you know, and I've shared the original artwork as well, you know. Then one particular artist perhaps may have said, you know, I'll send my idea into government, and they probably said, yes, great idea, we're going to launch it. So that's fine. You're giving a platform to young artists, blah, blah, blah. But maybe all these decisions were taken too hastily, maybe the people in charge of this particular project were not senior enough. So they just went, that's nice. And in good faith, they pushed it out there. As if it
because it was then a real grassroots effort that was done by people on the ground. Yeah. And, you know, I stand on it with the exception of the plagiarism thing, if that is true, is that all of this controversy is just absolutely ridiculous and frivolous. And it really shows the lack of, you know, the boliaoness of Singaporeans who can complain about
it. It's
booked on the bright side.
But I just found out, like half an hour ago, I read the Channel News Asia coverage of it, right? And there's another piece of information which bugs me now.
Yeah.
He said in his, I guess, you know, interviewed by Channel News Asia, he said that the images that were released were given by him to GovSG to explain and help them understand the characters that he was creating so that he could then officially be commissioned to do the actual comic, which means these were his proofs. They were never to be seen by the public. They were just to start a discussion. How would you like to change them? Maybe not Man United, you know, maybe certain things are sensitive. But before he knew it, it was out there.
No, but then, if that is the case, you don't resign. As an artist,
I think the pressure that he was getting, the bullying he was receiving.
The bullying.
This is something we need.
That one I don't condone. That one I don't condone.
The Man U guys like you, is it, Chris? Bullying from the Man U guys like you?
I wouldn't. Well, firstly, I hope not. And I really don't think, you know, fans would be like that. Right? But more so, I think the bullying is going to be about the whole idea of these characters that they came up with.
I mean, they are part of about spending taxpayers' money on something like this.
Yes, but, yes, that's the one.
And I'm sure those people would have targeted, you know, this boy.
Yes, you're right, John. Yes. Because, you know, the problem is that whenever anything comes up from the government, right, even if it is quite a decent idea sometimes, you're going to get a group of people who will just tear it down. And when you give them ammunition, exactly. And when you give them ammunition, when something like this goes askew, you know, for whatever reason, they're all going to just pile on that cyberbullying bandwagon. And some of the comments and some of the vitriol is just totally disproportionate to what we're talking about here. You know, it's not as if people's lives were lost or people got sick or whatever it is. It's a cartoon online, you know?
By naming the artist that way, you know, the government was literally blaming the artist, turning around and saying, we agree with you that this is bad, and that's the guy who did it. You know,
That is sad.
Defending the poor boy and saying, guys, cool down. We just wanted to support him. Maybe it's not popular with all of you. Let's review it. Rather than saying, oh, I'm so sorry. Look at him.
I agree.
Grassroots work don't.
We're going to review this. Yeah, we're going to review this again. I mean, give these boys a break. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? If I were them,
really
these people came in,
they really did
the best for us. You know, it's really not their fault. Like, defend them. You know what I mean?
They never defended the boy.
You didn't defend the boy.
I think what happens is, in a situation like this, especially when there's a young group, the not so good part about it is that the next time somebody wants to be creative, the next time somebody wants to come up with a new idea, that's the time before they can even put it out there. They're already thinking, oh my God, I don't want to go through this whole, you know, this backlash.
But, because these guys will not have my back.
Yes,
so why should I?
So that's something. But should we move on to...
Enough about this topic, basically. Right.
Hey, Gilbert, put on a big smile. Come on. Haven't you guys been feeling the heat this last couple of weeks?
What heat?
What do you mean, what heat? Am I the only one that comes out fresh out of a bathroom and starts sweating like a maniac?
It's called hot flashes, and it comes with menopause.
In
his case, it would have to be andropause.
This is bashing Chris Day, is it?
No. But actually, I have to say, okay, Chris, there is a scientific reason for this, which I find very interesting. Because of the decrease in pollution in the air, because fewer cars are on the road, a lot fewer cars. Yeah. Interestingly enough, a side effect of that is actually that more of the sun's rays actually hit us. So one of the side effects of having cleaner air is actually an increase in sun radiation and heat. So it's a good thing. So wear sunscreen and enjoy the fresh air.
Dude, we're supposed to be home, you know? We're stuck at home. And it's
so you go out to exercise, right? You must go out to exercise.
But even when you go out to exercise, you get the risk of heat stroke. You stay at home and you're in a sauna. And, you know, nobody's relieving any one of us of our utility bills. Maybe that's a good idea.
I'll give you a tip. Turn on the AC. Can I say something?
The reason why Singaporeans are feeling a lot more heat is precisely because they are at home. Now, having worked all my life, when you go to work, we are all in cardigans. Whether it is polluted, not polluted, the rays are touching the ground or not, we are shivering there because central aircon is there.
Yes.
With no central aircon, you're at home between andropause, the rays coming down, and that's why all the question here now is, guys, do you all have any suggestions of how to beat the heat?
Yes.
The only thing I worry about is to go out there and get me another 10 bottles of 24-hour deodorant protection. You know what I mean? Because the amount of sweat that is coming out for me each day. Come on, man. I'm going to spare my family members, too. If it's my smell. You know what I mean?
I mean,
if you don't...
With this extended circuit breaker, we're all going to be long-haired, long-bearded, sweaties by the end of it. I think the smell would suit us very well. In 6 weeks' time, we're all going to look like cavemen. Embrace it, man.
Okay, on that note, John, because no barbershops are going to be open for us, right? Yeah. Hairdressers and barbershops, right? You know why I wear a cap? I want all the viewers that's watching our show to know that I've still got hair, yeah? I got a whole head of hair, okay? And it's because it's so out of control, I got to put a cap on. You know what I mean? You'll be surprised at the amount of hair I've got. I'm not losing any. That's why I'm wearing a cap. No. It's bad hair days all the time.
I just want
my barbers open, man.
I'm looking at John's beard, and I'm wondering what he's talking about. Because he was exactly like this even before the barbershop closed.
Yes, so I'm not sure.
The man's an expert.
It's because I knew that there were going to be people rushing to the barbershop, so I sacrificed.
You were so kind. John. Thank you.
But most men shave at home by themselves, like, you know, so we will not have beards. We will have not nice haircuts and look like we went to the wood chipper. Okay.
But no, I mean, come on. How about those of us who bikini wax?
I'm sure
you're on a planet by yourself right now.
What do you mean I'm on a planet of myself? This is a very important thing to do. You know what I mean? And he's got to shut.
And then, you know, if you saw his Facebook, right? After talking about his need for a bikini wax, he then said he needs a rubber band for his bushy hair. And I was just getting all the horrible images.
I didn't say that. I needed a hairband. Okay? And everyone started making assumptions. It wasn't it great? I was thinking, what these people really are trying? They're connecting that with hairbands.
Okay. No, but you know,
let Daisy say something now.
But you know, Chris, you're right. Because I think it is their minds which are running to this. No. You have not meant it at all. And you have absolutely, you were not talking about any of those things. Where bikini wax is concerned, DIY, my friend.
Yes.
I'm just keeping people entertained, you know, during this period. You know what I'm saying?
That I have realized.
And that's my life. I have to entertain people. Man, come on.
Yes, and you've done well.
We need lightness. We need lightness and happiness at a time like this.
So now what are the suggestions to beat the heat?
When I was a poor student in Boston and couldn't afford an air conditioner in the summertime, I found a very easy thing is just get yourself a spray that you use to spray clothes with, fill it with water, sit in front of a fan and occasionally just keep spraying yourself. Exactly, you've got one right there. That's his little portable air conditioner right now.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah,
because you don't want to be running your aircon all day long while you're at home. Right, yes. That's terrible. Greta Thunberg will come after you. You know, right?
And the bill.
Jonathan, you're beginning to sound like Donald Trump. Stop it.
So,
or learn from our forefathers, get one of those lovely fans and just sit there like your akong and your ama and fan yourself.
Okay. You know? My suggestion is just go zen.
Meditation is cooling.
And no. Your mind is going to take you that you are actually right now in the cool air of the Himalayas. And as you meditate, you go from outside within. And you feel
Don't need. Just take your clothes off and that's it. Finish. End of story.
Otherwise, the temperature on the other side will go up very high.
Okay, now I see why you need a bikini wax. So that's your way of staying.
Maybe we can do our part to cool down our viewers, right? I think next week we can have all alpine and wintry backgrounds. Yeah. So as they watch us, they start to cool down.
We leave that to Gilbert to get the backdrop all changed.
Yes. On CNN,
Gilbert's our background expert.
You know, on CNN, there is a 30-second calm.
Oh, really?
Yeah, there is a little bit of calming, you know, the interstitial.
Yes.
We can all four keep quiet and keep changing the backgrounds and we can just show the fish swimming and go calm.
So everyone,
all the imagery play is happening now.
To watch us, yeah.
Okay, so now going back to our right side of life.
No, come Gilbert on. Has really good news that he was mentioning.
Yeah, good news from Gilbert. Yeah.
Let's feel happy.
Okay, all right. So, you know, in the midst of this extended CB, when everyone is cursing and swearing about this extended CB, another 6 more weeks, 5 more weeks, if you look at the positive side of it, this week's almost gone. This was a very good thing, and I think we need to highlight this and encourage this, is donations on giving.sg reached a record 13.6 million between the 1st of April and the 19th of April, as thousands of Singaporeans responded to donate their solidarity fund money that they got from the government. And this wasn't a small group either. On April 17 alone, in one day, 67,000 people went online to donate. And on average, they get a daily 3,000 to 5,000. So, you know, this is an amazing thing. And I think that we need to applaud this.
Yes.
And we need to encourage people to not just do it a one-shot thing. Because giving, you don't have to give such a huge amount as your entire solidarity payment every time. But do keep giving, because I think that is really what we need here, is to be able to help one another, whether or not we're in an extended CB period or not. So
fabulous, Singapore. Fabulous.
Should we take a moment and applause and scream, ayo?
Yes.
Ayo. Humble opinion, they really, each and every Singaporean needs this
applause. Okay. So, you know, for me, I would just want to encourage people to keep giving and look for different ways. Not just with money, but look for ways that you can give back and to help people around you. Be kind. Be safe. Be kind. That's what I would say.
Absolutely. Wonderful. Yes. Wonderful.
And during this period, you know, during this extended, this prolonged circuit breaker, people, please be happy with the ones you have at home with you. They are the people you love. Yeah. Don't get into this thing called cabin fever. Mm. And also, a blessed and safe Ramadan to all of our Muslim brothers and sisters.
Yes.
Have a
yes.
very nice one with your family.
Very, very true. Very true. I also want to say that in the bigger, larger scheme of life, it's just 5 weeks. It's just 5 weeks. So really, once again, go zen, stop complaining and tighten your belts, which you'll be able to do now because you'll stop snacking for 6 weeks. And so tighten it and let's get together. Mm-hmm. And look at the
bright side of life.
Thank you.
Yes. And I think as we are isolated from each other and all stuck in our homes, it's also ironically a wonderful time to start thinking more about each other, because we're not as, you know, tensed up and busy and chasing the rat race as we were previously. One important thing we can do, a small, simple thing that everyone can do to help our fellow Singaporeans, is remember it's Ramadan. Okay, there are many, many families who are fasting, and therefore they need to break fast at a specific time every day, which means they need to order food for their families. they need their delivery services to be available. So for those of you who are not fasting, if you can, adjust your own timing, order your meals earlier or later so that we don't sort of, you know, starve the ones who need to break fast.
Overburden. Overburden the delivery guys also.
Yeah. Yes, the delivery guys need to take their own breaks as well. So let's
shout out to the delivery people.
Yeah.
We can to get good job, guys. You guys working really, really hard.
You know, so it's been great having all of you here with us. Okay, we look forward to seeing you next week. Okay, keep smiling. All right, keep thinking of each other. And please like, subscribe, and share this with your friends and family. See you soon.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
See you guys soon. Stay safe.
I-O-H-O, in our humble opinion.
Hey, shut up, la.